For our next program, we're going to be looking to the future as we explore cryptocurrencies and the technology that powers them, the blockchain. We're going to unpack not only what these technologies are, but also how they will interact with the law and could be headed to a courtroom near you. I expect as we move through this discussion on both the blockchain and cryptocurrency that there may be a few questions. So if you have one question or three, kindly write them on the cards on the centers of the table, and staff will move around as you raise your hand to grab those questions and bring them up throughout the course of the program. We'll then hand them up to the moderator so the panel can be able to field them. So with that, I'd like to turn things over to our moderator and my fellow lawyer representative, Roger Townsend.
Good morning. We have a very exciting panel today. We have a distinguished group of academics from a range of disciplines that can shed some light on the blockchain, Bitcoin. It's something we've all heard a lot about of. Everyone who's come up to me has said, start with the basics. We will start with the basics. We will walk you through, and time permitting, we'll get into some of the more cutting edge concepts around Bitcoin, cryptocurrency, and the blockchain, the technology that underlies it all. We have today, we're very pleased to have Professor, I'll start from here, Professor Felton from Princeton University, who's a computer scientist, will bring a computer science perspective. We have Professor Athey from Stanford Graduate School of Business, who will bring an economics perspective today, and Professor Helm from the University of California, Irvine, who will start us off with an anthropological approach and visit how we have reconsidered the idea of what is money and how this movement can be placed from perspective of history. Taylor?
Thanks, Roger. I appreciate that. So, as Roger said, my name is Taylor Nelms. I'm an anthropologist of money and technology. And with a group of colleagues at UC Irvine and various other institutions, I've been studying cryptocurrency and blockchain technology since around 2011 or so. Bitcoin, the invention that sort of started us off on this path, emerged at a really interesting moment in time. So just think about the confluence around 2007, 2008 of the release of the first iPhone, the launch of a very important mobile phone-based financial services platform called M-Pesa in Kenya, and of course then in early 2008, the onset of the global financial crisis. Less than a year later, in October of 2008, on a cryptocurrency listserv, a programmer or group of programmers going by the pseudonym Satoshi Nakamoto released this now famous white paper in which it was claimed that in which he outlined a fully peer-to-peer form of digital cash with no trusted third party mediating the transactions. From the beginning, that was the orientation. The question was, how could we recreate money for a digital environment? Today, of course, Bitcoin's underlying blockchain technology has become just as, if not more, important than Bitcoin as a form of value itself. And people all around the world, including here in the United States, are experimenting with blockchain technology as a platform or a protocol for a variety of uses, from cross-border payments to trade finance and interbank settlement to capital markets to intellectual property rights, licensing and digital rights management, to data security and identity protection, to logistics and supply chain management. But of course, we wanted to start with the basics, and so to get us started off, I thought I would give us a very basic outline of what exactly the blockchain is, and then I'll let my co-presenters dive into some of its important characteristics and what makes it particularly unique and important. So to give you a very basic definition, and I'll read this so I don't mess it up. A blockchain is a cryptographically secured, publicly visible ledger or database It's shared among a distributed or decentralized network so that each participant in that network has a copy of the database. And then those participants together have to come to a consensus about the legitimacy of new entries added to that database in order to prevent anyone from unilaterally rewriting that record. So at its most fundamental, the blockchain is a technology for producing agreement. In practice, what does it look like? Well, first of all, Bitcoin, just as our primary example, is first and foremost code. Now, this isn't computer code, but this is just a representation of one of the very first collections of transactions on the Bitcoin blockchain, which is very biblically known as the Genesis block. In addition to code, right, it's software. It's a client that you can run on your desktop or another computing device that runs this code, and this is a screenshot of one of those early desktop clients. These are often known in this world as wallets, and it's through this interface, this software interface, that you can manage the value that's recorded on this database. Bitcoin, of course, is also, you know, in a way, the hardware that powers that software. So this is an early what are called mining rigs, right? The hardware that that provides the energy necessary to keep the database running. Nowadays, these mining rigs look a little bit more like this, much more industrial and professional. And then, you know, all together, these different mining rigs, these different nodes of software, these different nodes running code form a network, a global network, that maintains this distributed database. But as my co-presenters will discuss in more detail, you know, the easiest way to start to think about Bitcoin and its underlying technology, the blockchain, is as a ledger, as a simple database that is distributed again across an entire network. So it's replicated at each place. As an anthropologist, I see these blockchains as the latest contribution to a really long and vast archive of money's diverse forms and functions, right? From cuneiform tablets in ancient Sumer or Mesopotamia, which were used to record transactions of grain or barley or beer between different merchants and then stored in a centralized warehouse, to early modern double entry bookkeeping in medieval Europe, to mag stripes and mobile wallets today. Distributed ledger technologies like Bitcoin represent the leading edge of this much longer global history of accounting, right? Of the way that humans keep track of reciprocal obligations, the way they make, break, and negotiate contracts, the way they distribute and redistribute resources and preserve collective memory, and the way that we relate to authority. And so blockchain technology touches on these questions of reckoning in all of its senses, from mathematical to moral. And I just want to point out that in this way, Bitcoin and the blockchain doesn't necessarily fundamentally change what's at stake in reckoning, in accounting, but it does offer us new ways of pursuing it. So with that, I just want to pass it to Professor Athey, who will talk to us a little bit more about some of the qualities of this distributed database.
Great. So I came in this a little bit later than you did, but I started thinking about Bitcoin also in the 2011-2012 timeframe, and then really got interested in it in 2013. And so here I want to sort of, we're going to be building up to the more complex concepts. I'm actually going to present this from the perspective of around 2013, when people first started really starting to do things with Bitcoin. And I'll talk about sort of the kind of a very core base use case. So again, we want to think about the essence of what's being stored as a database or a ledger. And so even though it's not stored in exactly this form, in essence, what's happening is we have a big spreadsheet that says a from address and a to address, and how many Bitcoins or kind of tokens are sent from one address to another. Okay? And so every time a new transaction occurs, we put another entry in here. Now you might say, all right, a spreadsheet. This doesn't seem like rocket science. Like, I know about Excel and I know about Google Docs and Lotus 1-2-3 and we have bookkeeping for thousands of years. So, but I think it's actually, that is kind of what it is. It's just a ledger, and so it's important to not overcomplicate it. It's a digital ledger. The point is that if it's going to maintain things of value, then it needs to have some kind of security. So if I kept billions of dollars on my Google Doc, and then I might worry about various ways that people might try to rewrite that Google Doc. And so Ed is going to speak more about exactly how this security is achieved. But for the moment, let's think of it as that one of the breakthroughs is figuring out how to keep a ledger that has a lot of value on it secure in an environment where we can't necessarily establish identity through traditional means, and we're not relying on legal enforcement and other types of institutions to enforce what happens. So this is going to be sort of a self-contained system that works on its own through software. So, but Ed will elaborate on how it works. Let me go a little bit deeper into what it does, so you'll be interested enough to care how it works. the basic thing that you can do with the Bitcoin blockchain is that you can make another entry on the ledger. That is the key action you can do. And so here I have, one person, and I've written down a snippet of an address to emphasize the fact that this is pseudonymous. So there's an ID associated, and that ID has credentials that are controlled by a person, but when you look at the ledger, you don't know who it is. You just see the sequence of numbers and letters that identifies an individual, but we don't know the name associated with that. But if the blockchain says that someone in the past sent me a Bitcoin, then I can potentially make another entry that sends it to someone else. And that's really like the one thing you can do. Now, if you have this piece of software, which we talked about, this wallet software, what the wallet software really does is it helps you manage your credentials. So you'll have some kind of a passphrase to access your wallet, and then your wallet will authenticate into the network to make an entry. And what the software needs to do is check two things. First of all, it needs to check that, I'm authorized to do something with this address, and it also needs to check that I actually have been allocated the coins that I'm trying to move, and it's going to manage that. So going back to what you do with it, well, if you have this security software downloaded on your computer or your phone and you want to make a transaction, then you authenticate, and roughly 10 minutes later or hours later, depending on how congested the network is, another entry will appear that shows that now that token has been sent to someone else. And that's kind of it. That's what the software does at its core level. We're going to talk about lots of things you add on top of it, but basically you make entries that say that someone has something. Okay, so that seems at some level very basic. On another level, though, it's profound. Because if these things have value, and we'll come back to why they have value and how they have value, but if they do have value, then we're able to move something of value purely digitally and relatively quickly in a way that we've been able to move information like that for a very long time, but we have not been able to move value that way. So it's a way to move value or very, very quickly and purely digitally. So when I first learned about this, I thought, okay, this is very interesting, but as a system of value, if we started trying to use this like currency or money, it has some defects. Like, as an economist, I understand that you actually don't want to hold something other than dollars if you pay your rent and buy your food in dollars. And like the whole Eurozone is all about the frictions of exchange rate, and exposing citizens to exchange rate risk is actually a very bad thing. So the very first thought I had is, well, wow, this is really cool. You can move value digitally, but why am I exposing people to exchange rate risk? Why don't I move dollars digitally? And I think understanding the answer to why you can't move dollars digitally actually helps you understand how different, in some way, a different kind of asset, a Bitcoin or another cryptocurrency token might be. Because certainly I can write software in a ledger that says instead of one Bitcoin that says $1. I can write that software. And in fact, people have written that software. I can have a ledger that says this address has a dollar. And I can have cryptography that allows me to authenticate and put another message that says I sent a dollar to Ed. The software can say that. All of that happens, and it does happen. But what does it really mean? If there's an entry on here that says I gave Ed a dollar, that's a digital entry. But I can't beam a dollar bill and have it land in Ed's lap. So making an entry on a digital spreadsheet doesn't mean anything. It's just a message. So if I wanted to move dollars in this way, what I would really need to do is move IOUs. And so if you get back to thinking about, like, you have a Bank of America account or a Wells Fargo account, and you think, I have digital money today. What do you mean? I log in, I open up, it shows me that I have $100, you know, isn't that, and I can transfer it to someone else, so isn't that digital money? And I think the difference here is that you don't actually have a $100 bill in a safe deposit box with your name on it at Bank of America. You have a contract with Bank of America which says that if you ask for the $100, they have to give it to you. And if I ask to send $100 to Ed, they kind of have to send it to him. Now, they don't actually have to send it to him. In fact, the law says sometimes they can't send it to him because, you know, I might be violating some kind of, you know, various laws. They may be worried about money laundering, or if he's in North Korea, I can't send him the money. So the bank has a whole set of criteria about when it can and when it can't honor the contract to give me the money or send it to someone else. So you can have a digital ledger that keeps track of IOUs, but those would really be instructions to banks, and then the banks would have to decide whether to follow them. And so I think that's really the big difference with cryptocurrency, is that the entire definition of the asset is the entry on the blockchain. Like, if it says that I have, that somebody sent me a Bitcoin, I have the Bitcoin. It's not a contract, it's not a promise, it's not an IOU. If the entry's on the ledger, I have it. And if I have the key, then I can send it to someone else. We'll come back to this, of course. If you lose your key, you can look at your Bitcoins on the blockchain and look at them beautifully. And I know a number of people who can look at things that are valued in millions of dollars sitting on the blockchain, but they've lost their key. And if they've lost their key, they can look at it on the blockchain, but they can never access it again. Because, you know, any kind of transaction you make here is permanent. There's no undo button. There's no Bitcoin 1-800-INC that you call to restore your account. This is open source software that makes transactions with finality. And so that could be good. That could be bad. It's different. So we'll come back to ways it could be good, but there's also lots of ways it could be bad. But it is different. That's a fundamental thing. It's not an IOU. Having an entry on a ledger means you own it. It's not a promise. It is the thing. Okay, so now getting to the question of value, which is always the next question people ask, what can you do with it? So let me walk you through a simple thing that you can do with it that will answer a little bit of the questions about how it gets value and how you would buy and sell them. So suppose that I'm doing Skype tutoring in Japanese. So I found someone in Japan who can tutor me in Japanese over the internet video call. So we're finishing up our lesson and it's time for me to pay them. Now, I could send them a wire transfer for $100. That would cost me about $60 and it would take a couple of days. But if I was using cryptocurrency, I might have another option available to me. So if I was already holding cryptocurrency, that person has a wallet, I have a wallet, I could literally just send them that cryptocurrency directly on the spot, and they could actually see it arrive before we got off this call. And there's really no other way to move value internationally that quickly. Even if you're a company, you can't move it that quickly. Even if you're a bank, you can't do that quickly, unless you're moving among your own accounts. So this is really kind of fundamentally new consumer use case to be able to move money quickly and small value in a reasonably economical way. But if you didn't already have the cryptocurrency, then you would go through what are called exchanges. And here I want to highlight the idea that an exchange is a company, a corporation, that is providing services that are related to Bitcoin. So there, again, there's no Bitcoin Inc. There's an open source software project that creates the software for Bitcoin. But then there are companies that provide services related to Bitcoin. And those companies are just regular startup companies, which may be reputable, may not be reputable. They should be regulated if they're touching financial systems in a country, but some of them are located in places that are not as regulated or are not as compliant. So let's take the very compliant example. So suppose I have a US regulated Bitcoin exchange. What I would need to do to buy my Bitcoins is first I would go to open an account. Then I need to take a picture of myself with a passport, just like I would for a regular bank account, and go through the normal kind of KYC protocols for any money service business. So I would take my picture, send it in, open up my account, and then once I'm verified, then I could send a bank transfer through ACH, which is like how you pay your bills, or wire transfer to the bank of that Bitcoin exchange. And that cryptocurrency exchange. So once they have my funds, then I can buy and sell cryptocurrency for fiat. And so these exchanges basically just have an order book, so they'll display the order book. There's people buying, there's people selling, and the exchange doesn't set the price for cryptocurrency, it's supply and demand. And so the prices can move. There's nothing holding them down. If lots of people want to buy today, then the price goes up. If lots of people want to sell today, the price goes down. So once I have my account up and I have it funded, then I can just say, okay, I want to buy $100 worth of Bitcoins. I get the Bitcoins very quickly, almost instantly. Then I can take those Bitcoins and send them to the wallet of my friend in Japan, and they can get those in about 10 minutes. And so the key thing is that once I've got the whole system set up, I can move the thing of value very quickly. We can get off the phone, walk away, I'll never see them again. They have their Bitcoin or other cryptocurrency. Once then they want to get rid of it, they can either buy something with it, or they can go sell it on a Japanese exchange or any other exchange that offers trading in crypto to yen. And so then they would place an order to sell, take the marketplace price, and get their money transferred into their bank account. So this is actually a new thing, and the presence of this thing has actually put a lot of pressure on banks and money movers to lower their fees, lower their prices, make things faster and more efficient. Because it's now become possible for any two consumers in the world to move money, within an hour among themselves. And so that's actually a really big change. It's a very good change if you think about poor people remitting. There's, some countries have like a third of their GDP is coming through remittances, and having that be very expensive is, of course, very regressive. But it also can open up possibilities for people to get money out of a country quickly for bad reasons in a way that's sort of faster than ever before. From a consumer perspective, there's a couple of risks in the system. The first is that during the time that you've uploaded your money to the exchange and before you've taken the crypto out, that company could go out of business. They're holding custody of your funds. And although if you get in and out, you're only risking that for a short period of time, a lot of people actually, for convenience, hold funds there. And that can be risky. And those companies can go out of business for a variety of reasons. Actually, the most common reason that they've gone out of business historically is either some kind of big hack, or they've lost their bank account. So I was actually holding some money in a Bitcoin exchange in 2013. They lost their bank account. The bank was afraid of regulation. Maybe they thought the Bitcoin exchange wasn't doing its KYC well enough. Whatever happened, they went out of business. I lost my money, and I never got it back. So that's a type of risk that you face. And a second type of risk, even now we have much more reputable exchanges that are regulated and that are less likely to go out of business quickly, but you also face exchange rate risk, because the exchange rates are always floating and they could move within a short period of time. But if they move from year to year, that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to me for this purpose that it was $1,000 a Bitcoin last year and it was $18,000 a Bitcoin at Christmas. Those larger fluctuations aren't important, because I'm just taking dollars to Bitcoin and then Bitcoin to yen, and all of those exchange rates will move together. And so they'll go up, they'll go down, but all that matters to me is the variation in exchange rate during the time that I'm holding the Bitcoin, which could be short if I'm moving things quickly. But So I was very excited about this, and this is one of the things that got me into this to start with. I thought, wow, like we could really improve the human condition if we could let poor people move money economically and cheaply around the world. The remittance problem is a big problem, and a lot of countries are not part of the global financial system, and so this could be really good. Now, I ended up doing a research paper, again, this is now about 2 or 3 years old, where I looked at what people were actually doing, and this was happening. But actually, the biggest thing people were actually doing is buying and holding the Bitcoins and speculating on them. So we are still a ways away from sort of achieving this goal. And in fact, instead, what's happened is rather than this being like a consumer-to-consumer experience, instead, we're seeing businesses that provide this service but do all the work for the consumer, and the consumer never even sees that there was cryptocurrency involved. And I think that's really more the way it should be. The consumer shouldn't have to worry about all this technology, about exchange rate risks, about putting things on exchanges. If we really have a money movement problem we're trying to solve, the cryptocurrency can be used in the back end, and actually they're not even using Bitcoin because it's a slower, more expensive system than some others. So this type of thing is happening, but it's happening in maybe a different way and a more sophisticated way that kind of protects the consumers a little bit more. Nonetheless, this exact scenario does happen with some, you know, with regular frequency all around the world. It's just not the only thing or the main thing that's happening today. So with that, hopefully I've piqued your interest that this is a different kind of asset. It has different properties. It allows certainty of transaction, and it allows fast money movement, lower cost money movement, and it's different than just having digital dollars. And so hopefully that gets you interested enough to care, wow, like how do you do this? How can there be billions of dollars of value on this database? Can't everything be hacked? Like how has this not been destroyed by now? And so Ed will explain that as well as some of the more recent advances in how people are using it.
Thanks. So like my fellow panelists, I've been working in this space since 2011 or 12, both as an academic researcher and also during my time in the executive branch. I want to talk about a couple things. First, I want to talk about what this ledger actually is. So we've talked about the central role of the ledger, that it records all of the transactions that have occurred, and that if you have the ledger with all of the transactions there, that tells you who owns which coins now. And the system evolves via addition of new transactions to the end of the ledger. But how does this actually work? Who actually holds this ledger? One way it could have been done is to have a single entity, let's say me, be in charge of maintaining the ledger. Now, that's a pretty good deal for me because I'm maintaining this record that keeps track of who has how much money. And I feel pretty good about my economic prospects as the person who decides who has how much money. But you might not like that system. So instead, one of the key moves that is made in Bitcoin and other systems is to distribute the ledger. So the idea is rather than there being a central authoritative copy of the ledger, everybody keeps their own copy of the ledger. So everyone has their own list of transactions, and everyone's own list of transactions implies who owns which coins. So if we can keep all of these ledgers in sync, then we'll be happy. No one will have the centralized power to dictate what the outcome is going to be, but keeping them in sync is not an easy problem because, again, you have this incentive issue that my idea of what is a good distribution of money within this system might be different from yours. And so how do you get all of these parties, many thousands or millions of them around the world, who don't know or trust each other and in fact are weakly identified, how do you get them to actually agree on the contents of the ledger? That is the key technical problem that underlies distributed cryptocurrency design, and that was the problem that had been unsolved until the time of that first Bitcoin paper. Okay, so consensus is how do we get this worldwide network of weakly identified parties to reach consensus on the contents of the ledger. The answer that came in with Bitcoin is something that in the academic world is called Nakamoto consensus. That's the main breakthrough there. And the idea is it creates a structure which gives parties incentives to come to agreement about the contents of the ledger. And The full design of how that works and why it works is kind of subtle. But one way of thinking about it is it creates an incentive structure such that if people behave according to their self-interest within that consensus structure, an equilibrium will emerge in which they agree. So the process is in some respects like voting, but you get a ballot in this voting system by solving a difficult computational problem, by finding the solution to some esoteric equation. Within the system, there's a process called mining, and mining is essentially the activity of using big expensive computers to search for solutions to these equations. And many people do that. Why do they do that? Well, the reason they do that is that the next person to find a solution is rewarded by being given 12 and a half newly minted bitcoins. This is how bitcoins come into existence, through these payouts to people who solve these equations. Now, 12 and a half bitcoins is worth, give or take, about $100,000. And so that's a prize worth investing in trying to win. And indeed, there's one new solution found for these equations roughly every 10 minutes on average. So that is a lot of payout to the people who are engaged in mining. And not surprisingly, a lot of investment is made in doing mining. Now, if you find the solution to one of these equations, you have the ability at that moment to add a bunch of new transactions to the end of the ledger. And because of this very complex and subtle incentive argument, your incentive is to report accurately which transactions have happened. All right, so what are the implications of this? One of the implications of this is that this is a very expensive mechanism. This consensus process pays out rewards that average about $10,000 per minute, which means a lot of people invest a lot of money building those big mining rigs you saw before to try to compete for that. And in fact, this process is estimated to account for about 0.1% of all world energy consumption. That is enormous. Every 10 minutes, the Bitcoin miners collectively solve what is by far the largest and most complex computational problem ever solved by humanity. And then they do it again in the next 10 minutes. So this is really expensive. It uses a lot of energy. It's wasteful. But we don't know a better way, a better, cheaper way of doing it. And one of the grand challenges for the research community in this space is to try to figure out, is there a consensus algorithm that costs a lot less and is still stable in the sense that its incentives push people to agreement? All right. Now, I want to move on from there to talk about things that one might want to do in addition to simply doing payments within a cryptocurrency system. And this is kind of the cutting edge right now. And I want to start with the simple example of escrow. So you all know how an escrow transaction works. Here we have Alice and Bob on the slide, and Alice is buying a house from Bob. And so Alice is going, so they're going to pick an escrow agent who I've depicted as a referee here, and Alice is going to give the money to the referee. Bob will transfer the house in acceptable condition to Alice, and assuming that he did so, the referee will then pay the escrow funds on to Bob. If something goes wrong, the referee will figure out who's in the right and will either give the money to Bob or give it to Alice. Now, of course, this kind of transaction happens all the time, and it's done by some trusted escrow agent, maybe one of the party's attorneys. But within this structure, there are a bunch of things that could go wrong. The escrow agent could run off with the money, the money could be stolen from the escrow agent, or perhaps the escrow agent simply doesn't act at all, and the money just sits in their account. And it might be difficult or impossible for the parties to get that money back. So people working within the cryptocurrency space said, can we do this in a different way, in a way that reduces some of these counterparty risks with respect to this escrow agent? And so the idea arose to try to do this kind of transaction in a different way. I'll call this smart escrow. So the idea of smart escrow is you're going to create some kind of a digital lockbox which is managed by a cryptocurrency system. That is, we're going to have entries in a ledger that keep track of the state of this lockbox. Now, Alice will put her money into this cryptographic lockbox, and then Alice and Bob are going to specify a set of rules about how that lockbox should behave. It's a digital lockbox. It's implemented as part of a cryptocurrency system. And the rules of the lockbox are this, that if the referee blows their whistle, then the money will be given to Bob. If the referee throws their penalty flag, then the money will be given to Alice. And if the referee doesn't do anything by Tuesday noon, then the money is going to be split 50-50 between Alice and Bob. And so you will program up those rules in computer code, and you and those rules will be enforced. So let me go back. Right now, if you want to do escrow within a cryptocurrency, and let me stop for a minute and talk about why this might be preferable from Alice and Bob's standpoint. If this lockbox reliably behaves according to the rules, then there are a set of things that could have gone wrong before that can't go wrong anymore. The referee can't give the money to some third party or just run off with it. It can't be stolen from them. They can't fail to act, because no matter what they do by Tuesday, the money is going to go back to Alice and Bob. So this is preferable in some ways. It might be cheaper and faster as well, because you don't have to find maybe a bonded or deep-pocketed or deeply trusted, mutually trusted escrow agent. So you can take your cryptocurrency system and you can say, let's add escrow to it. We're going to add a new set of transactions in addition to payment transactions. We'll have a kind of transaction that makes a smart lockbox. We'll have a transaction that puts money in. We'll have transactions by which the referee blows their whistle or throws their penalty flag. We'll have a transaction that either Alice or Bob can invoke that says that the deadline has elapsed, now please split the money 50-50. And then we will have the ledger maintenance mechanism in our cryptocurrency. In the same way that it validates things like sufficient funds for normal payments, it will check that these rules are followed. And now we have a cryptocurrency system that, in addition to payments, allows us to have an escrow gadget. And that's cool. But of course, escrow gadgets are only one thing we might want to do. Once you have this idea of designing gadgets that do more than just payment, there are lots of kinds of gadgets you might want to design. For example, you might want to have a gadget in which some money gets deposited, and then if it rains today, the money goes back to the original source, but if it doesn't rain, then the money gets paid out to a farmer. And that allows the farmer to hedge the risk of that it won't rain in certain useful ways. And of course, we have financial contracts that do that, but maybe we could have a smart lockbox that does that. And that's a different kind of gadget. We could, again, extend our cryptocurrency system to add that gadget. But now, once we've added a couple gadgets, you can start to imagine other gadgets you might want. And certainly, as a computer scientist, my thinking turns to the question of, well, why can't you have whatever gadget you want? And this gets us to the idea of so-called smart contracts. And this is one of the hot areas within the cryptocurrency space. But the first thing I have to tell you is that this word contract is a misnomer. Don't read what you know about legal contracts onto this. Just, I apologize for the people who named this, but smart contracts is the standard nomenclature, even though it's not a contract. So with that said, here's the idea, that you can create a cryptographic lockbox that exists within a cryptocurrency system, and you can define any rules for its behavior. Any rules, you express them in computer code as to what this lockbox is supposed to do, and then the blockchain, the ledger maintenance system for your blockchain will enforce those rules. So you can have more than two parties involved. You can have any inputs. The input might be something like the referee saying whether Bob delivered the house as promised, or the weather service saying whether it rained yesterday. Any information that people give to this lockbox that can be taken into account in its behavior. And so that's the idea of a smart contract. The smart contract allows parties to agree to create functionality or gadgets and then have the cryptocurrency system enforce the behavior of those gadgets. And that allows those gadgets to operate in a way that is more reliable, has finality, which again could be a plus or a minus, but in some cases is a plus, and might be very cheap to do. One way to think about the operation of these smart contracts is not as a lockbox with rules, but to think of it actually as if it's a kind of robot that you can create within the system, which will act on its own and will respond to its inputs according to its code. It can receive payments, it can make payments, It can get information from others. It can wait until some timer expires and act in this way. And it's kind of useful to think of it as an artificially created mechanism whose behavior is enforced by a cryptocurrency system. Now, once you think this way, if that's not mind-blowing enough, now people are going to want to sort of treat that robot as if it is a first-class actor within the system, because it has the capabilities that a person might have. It can receive money, it can spend money, it can hold money, it can make decisions based on information and all of those things. You can allow people to put more of these bots into the system, and you can have bots trading and transacting with bots, and so on. So this smart contract idea, the idea of creating these artificial actors who behave according to code and yet can make and receive payments just like people, is very powerful. There's a lot of excitement about it, and the excitement about this reminds me in some ways about the excitement around the early internet. That the early internet couldn't do that much. It was sort of rudimentary. People hadn't figured out what it was good for. It was a relatively expensive and cumbersome way of sending information from point A to point B, but what was exciting about it was what you could build on top of it. And the excitement around cryptocurrencies and the excitement around smart contracts is really around the idea that just as with the internet, where we saw the emergence of a rich and complex set of business and legal and market structures that really serves end users in unforeseen and often wonderful ways, that the same thing might happen in this space, that this may become a platform for innovation around around payments and around the linking of payments to events in the world in a way that really wasn't possible before. And so with that, I'll stop and we'll pass it back for discussion.
Sure, well, now that we are all experts in cryptocurrency, we have our baseline. There are a lot of implications and considerations that come from this innovation. And one of the things we've talked about is how anonymous are these transactions? And how does it modify how we think about anonymity and whether or not bitcoins are a useful means to commit a criminal act?
So maybe I'll just start out with some kind of layman thinking about this. So if you think about like being on Twitter, you can have a Twitter account, but it may or may not be verified with an individual. That's how we get Russian bots spreading fake news on Twitter and so on. So you can think of Twitter as kind of pseudonymous in the sense that there are accounts and one person can have multiple accounts and so on. Within the system, you can track that account and see what it does and look at its history. But we're not really sure who the person behind the account actually is. And that's basically the way that the core kind of Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies work. A person can have an address and you can track the information. So we did an experiment a few years ago where we gave $100 worth of Bitcoin to all the MIT undergraduates. We gave the same amount to all these students on the same day. So even now, you can look back at the ledger and see, like, what did each of these students do? And did they send them to gambling sites, or did they buy stuff, or did they hold them and then sell it when Bitcoin went from $200 to $18,000, or did they send them to their friends, other MIT students? So all of that is on the public ledger forever. And in fact, one of the concerns I had when we gave the money to the MIT undergraduates was really, like, did they understand that their financial privacy was at some level being compromised. Now, what's interesting that's happened, at first people sort of thought about it as being kind of not subject to regulation because anybody could create an account, anybody could send it and use it, and it was pseudonymous. But over time, I think people have come to more appreciate that, you know, if an intelligence agency really wanted to find out which account was yours, there are actually a bunch of tools you could use to try to figure out who that pseudonymous account goes with. And then if they ever did do that de-identification, then your entire history would be visible and there'd be no way to get rid of it. And that can also be a concern just for a regular user. So if someone was holding, you know, $1,000 worth of value and that turned into, you know, $1 million worth of value, that's right there on the blockchain and everybody in the world can see that you have $1 million worth of Bitcoin. And if you associated your name with that Bitcoin address, suddenly you could become a target for crime or other types of things. And so that's a problem. Now, the system has then evolved. Within Bitcoin, there are ways to try to sort of disguise your identity, but also, and I'll let Ed talk about this, there are some new advances of coins that are more privacy protecting. And that you might feel good about that from a consumer protection perspective, but maybe bad about that from a law enforcement perspective. So up until now, a lot of the crimes have been actually traceable, and law enforcement has actually been able to utilize that, and also utilize the fact that in some sense, if you want to cash out a lot, you probably have to go through exchanges, and most of the best exchanges are regulated and do KYC and can be subpoenaed and so on.
Can you say, just to interrupt you for one moment, for those of in the audience that aren't banking lawyers,
KYC, know your customer.
Thank you.
So the regulation that says that if you are touching people's money and handling it for them, you need to know who your customer is and establish identity. And then there's thresholds. If you do more than a certain amount, then there's higher reporting requirements.
And this is when you set up your wallet, you have to send them all of your identifying information.
If you set up a wallet with the exchanges, but if you set up a wallet on your own computer, there is no such requirements. But if you wanted to sell $1 million of it, it's kind of hard to just like walk down the street and find someone with a suitcase full of cash, although that can happen. So
I would say from the average consumer's perspective, the vast majority of people are using exchanges.
Are using the exchanges, exactly.
Some of those exchanges are more reputable than others. Many of those exchanges, most of those exchanges now are regulated and require that you meet certain kinds of KYC or money transmitter regulations, especially here in the United States. But that hasn't always been the case in the history of Bitcoin, and it isn't the case everywhere in the world.
Yep. Exactly. So in some sense, it's like it's simultaneously very unprivate and pseudonymous, and so possibly very private. And so it's a kind of a hard thing to wrap your head around from that perspective.
So this, and this is the key point with respect to things like Bitcoin, right? That because every transaction is public, an analyst sitting at their desk can follow the money just by typing commands, and they can see it all, where it goes. That's the good news for that analyst who wants to follow, say, investigate criminal activity. The bad news is that the entities that are sending and receiving the money are just these pseudonyms, and it might be difficult to link them to real-world identities if that money never gets cashed out through an exchange or a bank, let's say. But this brings us to some technological changes that are happening now. This is the emergence of privacy-preserving or blockchains. And here the idea is that it is possible to encrypt the contents of a transaction so that if I'm making a payment to Susan, all that's put on the blockchain is some encrypted blob that nobody else can understand. She knows that she got the $100 that I paid her. She can verify that, and the miners, through advanced cryptography magic, are able to make sure that this was a zero-sum transaction and that the appropriate accounts, and that I have given up the ability to spend that $100 and she has gained it. Or what the miners can tell is that the amount of spending that I have given up is the same as what she has gained, and that what I've given up is something that I had, and yet they can do this without knowing what's going on. And so when this transformation happens, it means that for the analyst standpoint, it's bad news in both departments. It's bad news because the entities are pseudonyms, and it's bad news now because no longer can you follow the money by seeing everything in the ledger, because from the analyst standpoint, the ledger is just a bunch of encrypted stuff they can't understand. So this is emerging technology, which is starting to get a little bit of foothold in the market.
That's not what's happening with the Bitcoin blockchain.
Right.
That these are new blockchains that are being developed and haven't quite achieved the scale of adoption that Bitcoin has. Yeah. Bitcoin remains, the history of its transactions remains entirely public.
Yeah.
And in fact, we know from the sort of history of investigations, legal investigations, that pseudonymity is not quite as strong as we once thought it might have been, that these days it's actually quite simple to identify some of the major players on the Bitcoin blockchain.
And that sort of enhanced privacy for the ledger that I was talking about in these sort of new systems comes with significant cost and inconvenience for users, which is why they haven't all switched over and they're still operating on the public ledger or open ledger type systems like Bitcoin almost exclusively.
We started getting some initial questions, and there are several about mining. And what is the function of mining, and how does mining work in the ecosystem other than a means of meeting out the number of Bitcoin?
So let me talk a little bit more about why mining is necessary. So at a fundamental level, the consensus mechanism, the mechanism that incents people to agree, is a kind of voting process. But it's hard to hold a voting process when anyone can join the system and there's no identification of the parties. And the reason is that I can say I'm not one guy, I'm 1,000 guys, and so I'd like 1,000 votes, please, or more than 1,000. So this is what, and so this notion that somebody can get more votes simply by lying about how many people they are is a fundamental challenge to any sort of anonymous voting-based system. And so you need some mechanism to make sure that people don't claim to have a lot more identities than they do. And so the way that Bitcoin does this is to say that you're going to get votes in proportion to the amount of computing power that you devote to solving these esoteric problems. And you can't fake that, right? You can't fake that you have invested X amount of resource in trying to solve these computational problems. And so, from a technical standpoint, this solving of esoteric equations is needed because it's an activity whose cost you can't fake, because you either found the solution or you didn't. Once you found the solution to the equation, it's easy for everyone else to verify it. And because this is the only way we know to prevent this sort of multiple identities cheating, at least the only way that's known now, this is what Bitcoin uses. And it's super expensive. So, you know, is there some other way of generating an incentive structure that gets you to the same outcome? Who knows? Probably, but it hasn't been discovered yet.
Yeah, and just to kind of elaborate on that a little bit more, that at some level, you know, the amount that you spend has to have some relationship to the amount that could be gained by changing the system. And so the costs kind of scale up. There's an equilibrium where you have to kind of keep spending more and more the more valuable the thing is that you could try to steal, roughly.
Yeah. So just to elaborate on that and quickly, because this mining process, the process of consensus, is a sort of voting process, it would be a problem if somebody had more than half of the votes, right? If I have 51% of the votes in this voting process, now I'm just the dictator. I can get whatever result I want, and we're back to the situation where I can generate outcomes in which I have a lot of money. And so it needs to be the case that nobody can accumulate more than half of the power, the voting power. And that means that the system needs to be designed such that it's really expensive to get more votes than everyone else has combined. And how do you get votes? You get votes by spending money. And so if you cut you could cut the cost of mining down to 0.1% of what it is now, but in so doing, you would also cut down to the cost of becoming a dictator of the system by just spending more, also down to 0.1% of what it is now. So in a sense, you set the barrier to someone taking over the system at some level, and then unfortunately, the system has to burn that much resource in order to protect itself.
I would just say that mining is a metaphor. And in some sense, it's a good metaphor, right? Because it refers to the brute force, the brute computing force necessary to solve these computational problems that allow for the verification of the ledger. Yes. On the other hand, it's a bad metaphor because you think that there's some kind of physical activity going on. And, you know, the computing power is physical in that it uses energy. But what miners are really doing is providing the service of verifying the distributed ledger so that everyone then can look at it and agree, right, that it's the one, you know, that there's one ledger with one truth associated with that ledger.
You could also call them payment processors at some level.
Or clerks.
Yeah.
Clerks, yeah.
And we're getting a lot of follow-up questions about the mining process, and how is the equation determined, and
what is, where's the value come from in doing that?
All right, so you'll have to take my word for it that you don't want me to try to explain what the equation is. We don't have a whiteboard here. But here's what I can tell you. It has to be a type of equation that has certain characteristics. One is that it's very difficult to find a solution and that you can sort of dial up or down the difficulty to make sure that there's about one solution per 10 minutes. And so it has to be very difficult with adjustable difficulty to find a solution. At the same time, it needs to be very easy to verify the solution once it's been found. There also have to be a large number of different versions of this equation because every 10 minutes, we're going to make a new version of the equation. So if you think about a mathematical equation, it might have some terms in it that are added together. You might imagine that there's some term which gets changed in an unpredictable way every 10 minutes and which fundamentally changes the task of solving it. And so it has to be the case that every 10 minutes you can generate a fresh version of this equation, which is just as hard to solve as the other one, no matter how hard you've worked on the one so far. So it's a set of mathematical equations which have all of those properties, therefore there's a sort of esoteric theory about how this should be done. The original designer of Bitcoin picked a particular equation set which had these characteristics, and that's what people use today. Now, the people who are engaged in Bitcoin mining, this is a highly professionalized activity now, and they use special purpose computers that are specially designed just for the purpose of solving these mining problems. And that means not only are we burning 0.1% of all world energy use doing this, we're also constructing these giant data centers full of equipment whose only purpose is to do Bitcoin mining. And why does that happen? The answer is $10,000 a minute of reward.
So it's very competitive, and so if your equipment gets outdated, then you won't win. And so just one like, just very high level, though, the idea is that you want to verify that people are you have to burn money to do this. If you don't have to burn money, people would take it over. What's a good way to verify that people are burning money is to say that instead of rewarding you directly for burning money, I'm going to verify that you burned the money because you solved this hard problem, which can only be solved by burning money. And so you don't reward the burning money directly, you just reward the solving of the problem. And that's a way to in a very easy way, verify that people are burning money. That the only thing that is the result of the money burning is that you solve the problem.
Right, so it's the nature of these equations that the only way to try to find them is by, find a solution is by blind guessing. And therefore, if Susan has twice as many computers as I do working on this, engaging in this random search for a solution, she is twice as likely as I am to find a solution first. And in that way, your investment is proportional to your expected reward. And that's necessary to make the whole thing go. It's a way of picking, it's almost a lottery among the participants, and your chance of winning is in proportion to how much you're spending.
And let me ask also, there are several questions about the security of the exchanges as compared to banks, and the risk of hacking that is created from this new technology.
So maybe I'll take that on. I think that over time, some of the institutions have gotten to be fairly reliable. So we have U.S.-based exchanges that have U.S. investors that are pretty heavily regulated, have been inviting, you know, regulators to come in that are complying with all the applicable regulation or making suspicious activity reports, and they have been involved in a bunch of criminal investigations and have provided valuable data. They also have good boards of directors who are checking that they actually are not doing fractional reserve banking, but they're actually holding the assets that people have put there. So I think those are pretty safe. Nonetheless, like me personally, I had some funds in there that got much more valuable very quickly, and they actually had delays in terms of verifying the account to get them out. Because of regulation, you have to go through higher levels of know your customer in order to get larger amounts of money out. So if I had $1,000 and it suddenly became $20,000, I actually can't take it out until I go through their Know Your Customer. These are startups. They were not ready to scale. It took them about 5 weeks for them to verify my identity to the point where I could take my $20,000 out. At that point, I'm kind of nervous because over a 5 week period where lots of crazy things are happening to the price, like maybe something could go wrong and your money would be at risk. Nonetheless, I think the US-based ones are, you know, sort of fairly safe today from a consumer protection perspective. But early on, they were not so much. And then there have been some these things that are crypto-only exchanges. So these are exchanges where you can deposit Bitcoin and then you can buy Ethereum or you can buy other coins, but it's only crypto to crypto. And an exchange like that doesn't have to touch a bank. And if they don't touch a bank, they don't touch the regulatory system. So I could be in any country in the world and put up just a software product, which is an exchange where people buy and sell crypto, because I'm never touching fiat currency. It's all software. And so there are literally exchanges out there that you can buy and sell on, some that are transacting hundreds of millions of dollars, where we don't even like know who the CEO is, we don't know what country the CEO is in, and at any point they could walk away with your money. If you're holding any there. But they're staying in business because they're making more money on the fees from all these transactions than they would be from just stealing the money and walking away. But you would have no recourse if, you know, it would be very difficult to recover those assets in those scenarios. So there's a range of exchanges, and I think one of the interesting things is that there is, really from now and forever, there will be the possibility of crypto-only exchanges that are not subject to regulation. They probably will charge higher fees, and you know they'll probably be mostly used by criminals, because why would you want to hold resources on an exchange where somebody could walk away? So a regular consumer wouldn't want to be using those exchanges, but it's going to be hard to get rid of them because they're software products, and they don't require any kind of jurisdiction.
They are crypto only, which I think is a really important point to just sort of pause on. So there, you know, you can acquire crypto by mining it yourself, participating in the process of verifying the database and then receiving as a reward, right, crypto assets in return. To do that with Bitcoin is well, for us, impossible these days because the computing requirements are so high. For other cryptocurrencies, however, it is much easier to acquire them simply by mining. The only other way to acquire crypto with which you could then operate on a crypto-only exchange is to then buy it on a different exchange that accepts U.S. dollars or another national currency.
Or person to person.
Or person to person. So you could, you know, meet somebody on the streets of Anaheim and buy crypto.
You laughed,
okay,
but this happens.
Yeah, Disney's okay with it.
Yeah. On this issue of hacking, probably the key, there are two key facts about the way these systems work. One is that transactions are final. There is no undo. There's no one to complain to and say, I need to reverse this because it wasn't authorized. If it is properly authorized according to the cryptography and it's recorded in the ledger, then it has happened. So that's problem number one. So if I have a Bitcoin wallet on my phone and I forget my phone up here and it's unlocked and someone walks up here and picks up my phone, they could transfer that money off to their account and I'm out of luck. Because of that, I do not keep on my phone a Bitcoin wallet that has a lot of value in it. Those people who do, prudent people who keep a Bitcoin wallet on their phone have a little bit of money in that wallet, just like you don't walk around with your life savings in cash in your pocket. Instead, most of your life savings are in some safe institution somewhere, and you have a little bit of money in your pocket. So people are developing practices that are analogs to the way that people handle cash, because there's a finality to the transfer of cash as well, which leads us to be cautious to try to keep most of our value in safer places. Now,
I would say that there's also, people are attempting to develop forms of remedy or recourse in this space, right? So they're building on top of these systems, institutions that, as Ed said, replicate some of the institutions that we would use with national currency or other forms of value. And I would also say that historically, at least for big mishaps, there have been efforts to undo those mishaps. So if you're an individual consumer and you do an individual transaction and something goes wrong, chances of having that reversed are zero, basically zero. However, if you're a massive group of people using a system and there's a bug and something happens to the funds associated with that massive group of people, there are groups of coders and developers who could, at least hypothetically, and this has happened at least once in one of these systems, go back and change the database at some point in its past to restart it, right, from some other point in the database rather than the first point. So I'm just saying that there are responsible parties in some cases who are associated with these projects, and those responsible parties, you know, there are theories out there that suggest that those responsible parties need to be more responsible for the systems that they're developing.
So this is one of the crazy and non-intuitive aspects of a consensus-based system, right? That everyone has their own copy of the ledger, and the ledger advances by this kind of mechanized voting process, this complicated mining process. But suppose everyone in the world just decided that everyone in the world just decided it would be a better thing if Susan had $1 million and or a million bitcoins.
We can get consensus around that.
We could all just agree by talking to each other that we are going to put into the ledger a transaction that creates a million new bitcoins in Susan's account. And if we all agree and we all put that into our ledgers, then it's in the ledger and it has happened. So by sort of broad agreement among participants in the system, almost any rule change or any transfer can happen. But that is a process which only a person as eminent and respected as Susan would be able to pull off.
And I would say that the way that that would have to work, right, is through conversations that happen not on the blockchain. So what you can imagine, right, is that there are conversations in open source communities among developers, and we would normally just call that governance.
So, and then let me just come back to the consumer protection aspect of it, or the user's perspective. So if you're a user, you have a few options. You can use the basic system as it was originally designed, and you have your own wallet software on your computer, and you're the only one that has the keys, and then you're not trusting any, you know, evil banks, or you're not buying into the financial system, you're just your own custodian of your own funds, and it's only you, and you can send them to your friends anywhere in the world and kind of be off the grid. But from a regular consumer perspective, that's an awful lot of responsibility. And I personally know people who, from the early days, you know, there was even a Big Bang Theory episode about this, of like, you know, having bitcoins and having keys on a USB key or on a laptop, and then, you know, they were worth $10 at the time, and you threw the laptop in the trash, and then later on, they're worth millions of dollars, but you can't recover them. So that kind of, if you think about how many times you've forgotten your own passwords, you know, most of us actually don't want that responsibility. And like over Christmas, when these values went up, I found myself holding more than I felt comfortable with. And I'm very sophisticated, but I was like, oh my gosh, like I don't want these keys. You know, what do? I got to get rid of this stuff. Because it's kind of scary to hold, like just, oh, I'm not going to lose my USB key. Like, you know, I'm not going to lose this piece of paper. So then there are actually companies that have evolved that, you know, have vaults, like separate copies of the keys and various ways where you need to put together the pieces from the different vaults to recover them and so on. So the billionaire set in Silicon Valley has actually put a bunch of keys in these vaults that are, you know, around the world and with these companies that are trying to secure the bitcoins for them. And you might ask, well, like, what was wrong with Bank of America again? You know, got FDIC insurance. Like, that seemed pretty easy. And so I think, you know, if you're a billionaire, you're thinking about different kinds of risks, and maybe, you know, the bitcoins in a vault are sort of protecting you against a certain set of risks that bad things happen to Bank of America. But, you know, roughly, like, that's probably more sophisticated than a typical consumer wants. I think what you see most consumers actually doing is, like, keeping a little bit themselves and then keeping some on the exchanges and trusting that these U.S.-regulated exchanges are actually better custodians of their money than they are. Because the U.S. regulated exchange, you know, can recover my password. But, you know, there's no Bitcoin Inc. to recover my Bitcoin keys if I manage them myself. But once I'm holding them on the exchange, who do I trust? That there's no FDIC insurance on my account on Coinbase, while, you know, there is in Bank of America. So we need to get to a new point where the different use cases have the appropriate levels of consumer protection and security that are appropriate for the type of user.
Well, and you've each raised, and this question raises the role of the regulators and who regulates this, and so I'm going to ask you a question that's unfair for each of you, because none of you are lawyers, don't practice in this arena, but this audience is going to be interested in how does this impact the role of the courts? How does this impact who's regulating, who regulates Bitcoin? I think that's probably an unfair question, but I think you know where I'm going.
Well, so just in terms of U.S. regulators, interestingly enough, there's a real sort of patchwork approach at the present. And each regulator really has taken on, according to its domain, a different understanding of the assets in question. So for the IRS, Bitcoins and other cryptocurrencies are property. And you owe capital gains tax on that property, the same way that you would own capital gains tax on any property. For the CFTC, Bitcoins are a commodity, right? Regulated as a commodity by the CFTC. For the SEC, Bitcoins are not considered a security, but other more recently minted tokens, so to speak, probably fall under contemporary securities law. So there's a variety of different approaches already on the table. The real question is, for me, what are the other forms of regulation or governance at stake in this world, right? So there are external US regulators who will play a crucial role going forward and are already playing that role. But there are also, the industry groups, there are groups of developers, there are exchanges, there are mining pools, groups of miners who've come together to aggregate their computing power, who also play really important regulatory and governance roles informally in keeping these systems running and making decisions on behalf of the people who then use them.
So let me just layer on top of that, that from a policy perspective, if I think put on my consumer protection hat, I think it's better for consumers in developed countries to interact with businesses that are regulated in some way in their country so people don't run away with their money. And so the regulatory patchwork can actually initially made it kind of hard to exist in the United States. And so then U.S. consumers were, interacting with Mt. Gox in Japan. They were wiring money to Mt. Gox in Japan, which then went bust and had a lot of problems. So they were wiring money to companies from all sorts of countries around the world because there was not a U.S.-based company. And so I think consumers became more protected when we were able to figure out how an exchange could be compliant in the U.S. So, over-regulating can just drive this out, and that's particularly true in the space because it's just so global. And so the regulatory uncertainty has been a real impediment to innovation. We can't make this go away globally, so my personal view is that we should be figuring out how to allow people who want to be compliant to be compliant. Then there are some square peg round hole issues in the sense that, just as was alluded to before, different entities are trying to accomplish different goals and then putting labels on things that don't fit globally. And so just like a consumer protection issue is that some consumers didn't understand that every time you transacted from one crypto to another, they were having a capital gains event. And so they might have diversified away from Bitcoin at Christmas. They bought other coins, so they realized the capital gain. So they bought a Bitcoin at a low price. It came to a high price. They said, I don't want to only hold Bitcoin. I'll buy some Ethereum. So they sold it to Ethereum, realized the capital gain. Maybe they had the money stuck on an exchange, and they couldn't even get it out. The prices fell in half. They have a tax bill for the capital gain, and they can't pay the bill. And so I think that this happened to a number of people this winter. So, we need to educate consumers, and we also need to make sure that the way that we're treating things is clear and that people can sort of comply with the regulation.
Just let me interject to the Ethereum, so people know, is
another cryptocurrency, yeah. Right. And then I guess the last issue is that there have been these ICOs where companies have basically been formed. Typically what's happened, the bad example, so a stereotypical bad example, of which there were hundreds of these, is that somebody writes a 5-page paper. They say, I have a great idea for a new crypto startup. They ask people to invest in this venture, and they say, I'm going to give you a token in return, and then when my venture succeeds, my token will get very valuable for a variety of reasons, and you'll get rich. And they did this on the basis of like a 5-page paper. And so the problem is starting a business is pretty hard, And so most of those five-page paper ideas for businesses, if they weren't, even if they weren't intentionally scams, failed, and a lot of them were intentionally scams, and so a lot of people lost money. And there, if you think about securities regulation, there are reasons that we protect consumer investors against investing in companies, why a company can't just say, invest in me and take money from random consumers. And so that purpose needs to be served. But the way that the regulations have been written and also enforced by the courts in the past does not squarely fit all these new scenarios. And so that's been going to be a challenge for the courts and for the regulators and everybody else. Yeah.
I would just say that the token, really the legal status of the token itself, is quite fluid and dynamic, depending on the regulatory domain and the use case in question.
It's maybe worth talking about the ways in which even small businesses could use crypto tokens for financing. Just to give you an idea of how this might work, I mean, suppose I wanted to open a family restaurant down the street. I might create a new kind of cryptographic token. This is very easy to do in a system like Ethereum. And I might sell that token and say, I'm gonna auction it off, and each one of these tokens is good for a dinner at my restaurant after I open it. And you can resell these tokens to somebody else. There might be a market in them until I open my restaurant. And this is a way I might get cash that I can use to pay the startup costs of my business. And that's pretty great if I know what I'm doing and I'm on the level and the restaurant actually opens and people get their food. But you can see there are lots of ways in which this could go wrong. It could be a scam, I could be incompetent. And in any case, I'm selling something which, you know, you have to ask the SEC, is this a security or not? But without the, but in a sort of mom and pop way that isn't conducive to the kind of consumer protection approaches that might have been used before. So this idea that many different kinds of businesses can raise capital by selling these tokens because it is so cheap and easy on some of these systems to create a new kind of cryptographic token and sort of open a market in it, that could be very empowering for businesses to raise money, but also raises all kind of consumer protection issues.
I'd like to shift gears a little bit to the blockchain and how the blockchain, we hear about the blockchain as this great tool, authentication tool, that it's gonna be used to solve voter fraud, to address supply chain issues. We got several questions about the ways in which the blockchain can be used outside of cryptocurrency.
Let me talk a little bit about the different kinds of blockchains that exist. So when we were talking about Bitcoin or cryptocurrencies earlier, we are talking about a distributed ledger, which is distributed and sort of has anonymous participants or pseudonymous participants. And that's one kind of blockchain. There's another kind of blockchain or ledger that's just published by a single known entity. And that is a much older technology. It doesn't have this consensus problem. And for many of the sorts of applications that people talk about blockchains being useful for, a centrally published blockchain that's published, a centrally published ledger that's published by one entity can be a really good solution. What it lets that entity do is publish a set of statements or a set of actions that they have taken or made. And in such a way that there is a permanent record that they can't take back. And that can be really useful for various transparency and accountability purposes, and there's lots of applications of this. The point of this is that the notion of a blockchain, that is the use of a public ledger as a mechanism in designing all kinds of public systems is important, but it doesn't necessarily have to carry with it the sort of fully distributed decentralized way that that many of the cryptocurrency blockchains work.
So I just build on that, there's, if I wanted to sum up what the impact of all of this has been so far, the impact has actually been much more pushing innovation forward than a large number of worked out use cases yet. I've probably had hundreds of student groups come through my office with ideas for startups and other just random startups showing up in my office or emailing. And the typical journey that they go through is they say, oh, I'm so excited about the cryptography. I have this great idea. It's gonna solve problem X. And then they work for 3 months, and then they come back and say, wow, blockchain would improve upon the current state of the art, but actually there's something simpler than blockchain that would also improve on the current state, and it's actually better. And so it's actually, so none of this conversation would have ever happened if there wasn't, in some sense, a proof of concept that something beats the status quo. But it's often the full glory of the blockchain is not really needed. You don't really need the trustlessness. You don't need people to be able to come and go all over the world. You actually know the parties you're transacting with, and you have a little bit more trust in the system. So some kind of database is useful, but it doesn't have to be the full blockchain, which is expensive to maintain. But there are a few, I think, exciting use cases that I believe do have a fair bit of promise. There's more than a few, but I'll mention a couple. So one is just actually this basic money movement. That is happening, and you know, there are companies that are building on top of cryptocurrency to move money internationally cheaper. So I'm involved with a company called Ripple that does this. But there's a couple of other applications, and basically for some corridors between small countries, cryptocurrency can be a faster way to do this. And this is all being done on the up and up in collaboration with the central banks and the banks of those countries. In fact, in some parts of the world, the central banks are very supportive, because if you're a small country, your companies and your economy is disadvantaged by being dependent on, you know, the large banks and paying markups to those large banks and the delays. So the countries that are badly served by the current system, actually the governments and everything, are trying to find better ways to ease the payment system, like for remittances and so on. Then I think another category we've already talked about, but I really just want to highlight, is the smart contracts. So in the end, we use escrow for houses. And we use it, you know, for big things. We use title for cars, but when we have to do car loans. But there's a whole set of like smaller things where having the ability to do escrow would actually really help. You don't have to pay the lawyers. You don't have to pay the title agent. And those transaction costs can really prevent transactions from occurring. So I think that, you know, these smart contracts will get commercialized and developed for a new layer of use cases where escrow would be helpful, that has not risen to the level of having institutions to support them today. And then the financial contracts and the derivatives and the hedging and the risk sharing for small farmers and, you know, lots of financial applications, where I think that just being able to have the certainty will help. And also IoT, Internet of Things. We may have devices that want to pay each other, that want to borrow. You might be walking through a building and wanting to borrow energy or bandwidth or computing power from other devices. We could have, you know, lots of settings in the future where we'll have little computers everywhere, and those computers need to transact, and they need to transact at low cost and make small payments. Digital rights, so people taking photography of news events around the world. It's going to be sort of a low-cost, low-value transaction, and you want to be able to sell across borders and maintain the rights to your digital assets. So I think that's another kind of use case that would you know, potentially fit this, where you don't have a lot of trust, or international supply chains, where you have a lot of small businesses involved and you don't really know all the players. So I think that there are definitely interesting examples. The payments one is really one of the only ones that's really fully commercialized and sort of ready to happen at scale, but some of the other ones may get farther as we go along.
Yeah, I think that Susan and Ed have touched upon the really big use cases that people are very excited about. I'll just say that in all of these use cases, there are trade-offs involved. One of the biggest trade-offs, I think, at least from my perspective, is in these blockchain distributed systems, what happens is the points of vulnerability get distributed as well. So instead of there being one centralized point of vulnerability at the center of a network, often what you get are a whole bunch of different points of vulnerability at the edges of the network. So just to give you two examples, one in the world of payments and money, we've already talked about how in these distributed cryptocurrency systems, the points of vulnerability are really at the level of the user. Right, so you have to become your own bank, and not everybody wants to become their own bank. In the case of supply chain or logistics, right, the points of vulnerability are really about how do you get physical goods or digital goods How do you get information about those goods onto a blockchain where they can then be tracked, right? So again, you have this displacement of vulnerability from the center of a network to the edges of the network, right? And so if you're thinking about governance of or regulation, what you're really thinking about is governing or regulating the edges of the network rather than the center of the network, which is where the blockchain is strongest.
Well, thank you, everyone. We're scratching the surface on this topic, but we've run out of time. So can I join everyone with a round of applause for our panel?